Okay, so for a few months we've been working on electrification in India in general. There's a team of us, there's three of us, we're working on electrification of buses, intermediate public transport, that's share autos, e-rickshaws, and then micro-mobility modes. I'll today talk about electric buses in general. So a lot of talk about electric buses in India happens around the FAME scheme. FAME scheme is faster adoption and manufacturing of electric and hybrid vehicles in India. FAME 1 scheme came around 2014, I think 2017, end of 2017, I'll finish that. End of 2017, they realized that, we haven't spent much. And in fact, until 2017, there were no electric buses included in the scheme. Until then, only hybrid buses were included, and the first fleet was sanctioned, I think, for Mumbai. There are about 25 buses operational even now. Later then they said a lot of STUs, state transport undertakings, went to Department of Heavy Industries, which anchors the scheme. They went to DHA and said, we want to try out electric buses. And then DHA said, we'll come up with a scheme for electric buses as well. At that point of time, if you had 35% localization, the subsidy guaranteed was 60% or up to 1 crore. Between all of this, there was this case of electric buses in Himachal. There was a case in NGT, and NGT said, no diesel buses in Rohtang Pass. And then they said, we can do CNG buses. But then Himachal Road Transport Corporation also thought, why don't we try electric buses? They went to DHI. And at this point also, there was no scheme yet notified for electric buses. So they were given a 90-10, so national government was giving them a 90% funding, and the state government put 10% to buy the buses. This is also probably the first time electric buses were tested at that height. It was possible, and they saw possibility, and they actually got the buses as well. Following which, there was an EOI in December 2017. Around 44 expression of interest. EOI. Around 44 cities submitted their proposals, and 11 cities were selected. Unfortunately, it took over more than a year for cities to actually operationalize those fleets. Now, I'll talk about one case of Hyderabad where one such fleet was actually operationalized. This Hyderabad was the first city in India to operationalize 12-meter AC buses. All of them are on airport routes, and the cost per kilometer they negotiated. Initially, it was quoted 40 rupees. They negotiated it to 33 rupees. Also, we also always need to understand for FAME 1, the subsidy was 1 crore. So the operator was able to offer buses at a lower cost. And also the operational kilometers per day in Hyderabad are pretty high. On some routes it is 350, and other routes it's more than 450 kilometers per day. Now, how are they able to do it? It's because one, the way they've scheduled the buses. They're running the buses 24/7, but there is a lean time in the afternoon, 2 hours, when the buses come back to the depot and they're charged. So there's a 4 hour charging time. All buses aren't charged at once. The way they're scheduled, they're charged over the day. Hyderabad doesn't have a differential pricing in the morning or the night. It's the same all through the day. So they're able to do it right now throughout the day, and they're spending 7 rupees per kilometer on energy. You compare it with a diesel Volvo bus, diesel Volvo low flow AC bus. The cost per kilometer on diesel itself is 23 rupees. They're able to break even now. In fact, this month they've crossed, their earnings have crossed cost per kilometer. They're earning more than 42 rupees, but that is also because there's no conductor on these buses. If you usually see for a state transport undertaking, 50% of the cost is establishment cost, but that needs to be there because we don't have any way to reduce the cost. the recent buzz is around FAME 2 scheme. FAME 2 scheme seems to have done some course correction, although there is a lot of resentment from the industry because there's very few subsidies for electric cars this time. They are subsidizing electric cars, but the focus is on electrifying fleets. Here we'll focus on electric buses itself. So in the government of India intends to support about 7,000 electric buses, and in the first EOI they've committed to give subsidy for more than 5,000 buses. Now cities eligible for these incentives were million plus cities, smart cities, satellite towns, and then intercity buses connecting to all of these cities. In Tamil Nadu, I think about 12 cities applied for subsidies and 8 have been selected. Unfortunately, Chennai is not part of this. Coimbatore, Trichy and Madurai being the million plus cities are getting the most of this. They're getting 100 buses each. Now, the important point here for all of the STUs is to figure out, okay, they've submitted a proposal to get the buses, but there's still no clarity on where the buses should go. And also at the depot level, where the energy is coming from, because a lot of these depots are still HT, they have HT connections. We might not get the same rates that we got during FAME 1 because the subsidies, the maximum subsidy guaranteed has come down. Earlier it was in FAME 1, for example, Hyderabad got 1 crore per bus. The operator, Olectra, who is operating, got 1 crore per bus. Now the 12 meter bus, it is capped at 55 lakhs. So point is, we might not get the same rates, and if you're getting 70 rupees per kilometer and add to that energy cost of 7 rupees, and the earnings per kilometer for most STOs in India doesn't cross 40 rupees, so that gap will still be there, and the state government needs to figure out how are they going to fill that. I think that's it from me.
There are various specs, like based on UBS, which is urban road spec. We have developed most of the buses, but at the end of the day, it's what the government decides what is needed as spec. So, capability to manufacture buses are there, and design and manufacture is available. So, lead companies are ready for it. Only thing is now up to the government to decide what kind of specs or features they want in the process.
Thanks for the presentation. A question I have is this the government adoption of electric automotive, is that the only option, or these days pretty much I think you're probably looking at, for a city like Chennai, maybe somewhere in excess of 50,000 buses that shuttle people from their homes to their offices that are spread around all over Greater Chennai area. Are those good potential for being replaced with electric technology? Because these buses, they fly in the morning and then they park in somewhere till 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock in the evening, and then they do another trip. What are your thoughts on that? Have you approached private companies for fleet operators?
Yeah, more than staff buses, the break even is not very good. But what is right now happening is private operators for intercity operations up to 300 to 350 kilometers. This is feasible with electric buses. It's in the process of, people are in the process of finalizing, because in terms of cost per kilometer of operation, it's nearly on par.
How feasible is it to have electric buses that are not powered by batteries, but not on overhead traction lines?
Okay, so there's been interest in doing such stuff, but the problem with that is installing such infra will be costly. Actually, there are three types of charging for electric buses, right? One is overnight charging, and another is intermediate charging. The reason why a lot of cities are going for overnight charging is because installing the infrastructure across the city removes the flexibility of a bus, because if you put overhead traction, the bus is stuck to that road. You cannot move it, and you're forever bound to that one. But if it is overnight charging, or let's say the swappable batteries like in Chennai right now, the bus can do any route that the operator wishes to. So that's.
Thank you.
Just adding on to it, you know, some cities have this, Shanghai has this on certain routes where there is high density, and where they put, and this is like going back to your old tram technology, not nothing more than that. So
the trams are working extremely well as well in the world.
Yeah, I'm not saying anything about it. It's end of the day, it is the government that needs to come out with policies like for high density roads. You have metros in, being built in Chennai. You can build much higher, you know, cheaper systems at, you know, much much more traffic carrying, like a BRT corridor or something which can be done similarly.
Okay, so I think during film work there was some incentive being given for retrofitting buses. There was also a company KPIT which was doing all of this, but I don't see any transport undertaking showing much interested in retrofitting. Could be done probably in private cases, but for a transport undertaking right now, the finances are so bad, they just don't want to try anything new.
More than the cost, it's not about the cost. One, the condition of the current buses are not very good. All are pretty old. Second,
I'm not really talking about school transport. I'm just because around, I don't know, STD have a lot of engineering colleges in Sambara, so many buses flying, so I had those engineering colleges in mind when I asked. So if the retrofit cost is not all that much, you know, they can be, no, it's, you know, like, I think he also asked about the question of engineering colleges.
It doesn't really work out economically for electrical buses. See, if you look at nearly 50 to 60% of the cost is the cost of batteries. So if you retrofit an old existing bus, it's not going to add, because then you need to get approvals and all that. It's more economical to go for high density, high usage routes for electrical buses.